Welcome back, twitch.tv/EvilSqueegee. I'm Evil Squeegee. Today we are playing some Lasers and Feelings. This is the first episode of our new weekly Sunday one-shots. Sunday. Alright, and we're playing Lasers and Feelings because fuck prepping another Everdeep adventure when I don't even have Wednesdays prepped. So, today's players are the one and only Pyromancy. Wave hello, Pyromancy. Pyromancy today will be playing... you are playing... the alien unicorn, who is an explorer. His number is 5, which means he's really good at, he's really good at logical decision making. His name is Victor Cool, and his goal is to find new worlds. Imagining Mystic is going to be playing, where the fuck are you? Crash Whizbang, the dangerous engineer who is very bad at anything logical but fantastic with people. Who wants to shoot bad guys. And is required by contractual agreement with the GM, to do the following. It explodes!
Yay!
Alright. And then we have Zangmak, who's playing Randy Spacebuck, the sexy scientist whose goal is to meet sexy aliens, with that middle-of-the-road number 3. Alright. And then there is Johnables, who is playing Maximilian Pegasus, the intrepid pilot. Who likes Looney Tunes, apparently. Alright. Whose goal is simply to keep being awesome. And today, the Raptor is a fast, well-armed scouting ship with horrible circuit breakers. And in today's adventure, cyber zombies are going to steal or capture the quantum tunnel, which will, if they succeed, reverse time! Okay. Now. As our adventure begins, okay? Victor, you are poring over the maps with your horsey eyes. You'll be scuffing the bridge ship with your hooves, swishing your tail back and forth, looking for where the cyber zombies might strike next. You have been sent on the Raptor as a scouting party by the Consortium to protect the Consortium worlds against the known spreading threat of the cyber zombies. Cyber zombies are a cybernetic plague from the future who accidentally fell through the quantum tunnel. Discovered, strangely, by the Raptor. Only they had a very different crew back then, in the future, whenever it happened. The point is, cyber zombies fell through the cracks of time and into the past, and they're now upon you, drastically changing the course of the future. You are also from that future. This is why this discovery of the quantum tunnel was in the past, right? So now your ship is coming through the quantum tunnel, chasing after these cyber zombies. You have much experience with combating the cyber zombies. You know their weaknesses, namely that they don't have many, and you know their driving motives, simply to spread and eradicate all life that is not already cyber zombies. They kill you, and then they implant their cyber things in your brains, and they make you into cyber zombies that eat brains and computers. Because in the future, it's politically incorrect to not consider androids people. Now, you are looking over the map, Victor, trying to find which world seems to be most ripe for opportunity with cyber zombies. Meanwhile, Crash Whizbang! You are patrolling through the ship's armory. It is plentiful, filled with weapons of all shapes and sizes. You have come here armed for combat with cyber zombies. And that is combat indeed. Combat that you are looking forward to because you will finally get to shoot bad guys. Guardian has always kept you in the engine room, or the boiler room, or the computer room, always making with the technology, even though you've never been very good at it. Things tend to explode around you. But now, because your crew is so small, there will come a time, you are sure of it, that you will get the chance to shoot a bad guy.
My destiny will finally be fulfilled.
Randy Spacebuck! If you are to change the course of future, you will look damn good doing it!
you ready to face the day?
Oh, and the day doesn't even know what's gonna hit it, baby. The way those pants just fit.
Oh, they are on point.
There.
You can actually see a point down there.
At least now I know what gender you're playing. And those shoes! Those manly, fuck me shoes! Oh, you're gonna kick some ass in these puppies.
Go get some ass.
Ooh, oh yeah. You're here to kick ass and take ass, and you're all out of ass.
Shit!
Shit! Oh! And then... Maximilian Pegasus! The greatest pilot ever to pilot anything for the consortium. Out the window, you can see time rippling as you shoot down the quantum tunnel. Your ship in time yump mode. The ripples in space and the ripples in fate. The timanium sparkles in the atmosphere around your ship as your temporal yump drive is slowly starting to burn out. It will be some time before that energy has recollected and the temporal yump drive can be used to go home. And so fearlessly, you look out the window, and then back to your Looney Tunes on the small TV on the display of the and then back. You know, space in the distant past looks just like space in the present. Or I suppose it's the future now. Empty. Lit by sparkling starlight. You find yourself wondering what strange and primitive technologies you might encounter on your trip through time. And then, you find out. Your ship leaves the quantum tunnel. And while Victor is poring over the map, trying to pinpoint the first place the cyber zombies will strike, it occurs to you that your orders are complete and total genius, Maximilian. You see, your temporal coordinates were given to you by the consortium. And as any fearless pilot, you will shoulder the burden of doing that which needs to be done. If the consortium needs someone to do something that they might not return from, you are the man who will do it. And you will do it as best you can, and that means going to the exact point in time the consortium has deigned you go. And so you do! And the genius of it is, you realize as you look at the clock, the cyber zombies have not arrived in the past yet. So you set the ship into orbit around planet. What is this? Earth? Oh yeah, Earth. Wasn't that the birthplace of humanity? Ah, yes. What an historic point in history to have arrived at. As the temporal yump drives die down, the ship falls into orbit. There is this light rumble as you're falling into sync at 1 second to 1 second. Your 1S 1S time speed is finally established. And you find yourself, after moments go by, under a barrage of signals. It would seem that many communications are coming to your ship from Earth. What do you do, Captain?
I would imagine the Captain remains frozen in his escape pod, because the Captain is straight fucked.
Oh yes, that's right. Darcy is not with us right now. So as the standing leader of the ship, Maximilian, what do you do?
a lot of communications today. Victor, jump on these. Give him a listen.
Yes, sir. I'll go listen to these right now. And I turn around and kind of smack him in the head with my tail.
Watch that. Told you.
Sorry.
So, Victor. In the distant future, equal opportunity employment from the consortium is a top priority. And as such, while there are finger-based buttons, there are also hoof-based buttons on the floor, just for you and your species of alien. So you will clop on over the bridge, and you will step on each of the buttons needed to activate, and look at the array. There are so many, it's difficult to count, and all of them seem to be displaying in various different fonts? No, those are different languages. Oh my. You know, if memory serves, in ancient times, Earth was not a unified planet. It was filled with many fractured and fragmented, what do they call them? These cultures, these sub-planet divisions. Nations? Each one with its own culture, as if it was each one, you know, like a miniature planet just sharing the surface of one, like some strange, violent jigsaw puzzle. Eventually, they abandoned this somewhere circa the year 3000 as it was untenable to just maintain so many differences. And if you wanted a different language, a different culture, you just went to a different planet. With rising populations and the never-ending conflict that broke out, it was just more peaceful and more efficient to just shape up and ship out, so they did. But this is apparently before that had happened. You may have entered quite the political hellstorm here. Which communique do you open first?
Well, first I'll take out the little communicator and start translating some of it, just so I can get a rough idea of what they're trying to tell us.
All right. So of the bunch of communications, there's none of them are speaking Galactic. Right, none of them are speaking Galactic Common. There's this one. This one says, "Greetings, aliens from space. We welcome you." Another one says, "The fuck are you doing in my space, you asshole? I will blow you up." That one's got a face of some rather round-looking Korean guy. And then there is the "We invite you to come wrestle bears with us," signed Putin. Which of these communicated does Victor take interest in?
I think I'm kind of interested in wrestling the bears.
You want to wrestle bears, Victor? Do you? All right. So, go ahead and roll me feelings, Victor.
That's gonna be don't roll at all. That's gonna be a botch, thanks to Yumi.
All right, so you bust out your universe translator and you're looking at the screen through it, right? Like it's almost like that augmented reality technology that must be so new to these strange primitive people. And you kind of it translates for you as you're looking through your phone camera, and you look down and oh, bear wrestling. I wonder what a bear is. And you click that, right? And up comes this very serious faced guy. He doesn't have much hair. Doesn't need it. Whatever bears are, you're assuming they're manly as fuck just looking at the way this man carries himself, right? And he speaks. And he says, "Welcome to Earth." And you go to respond, and what is it that you say?
"So what's this about bears? I'm really interested in what you're doing with them, wrestling with them."
So as you are talking, right, Putin kind of tilts his head and then grows more serious, right? And he's looking at you confused, right? And all in one fell swoop, you realize two things. One, somebody needs to be drawn back to Discord. Yeah. It would seem that on your communications network, the sexy doctor... Oh, I'm sorry, it was the engineer. The engineer got caught up in some other system of communication. We fixed it. All right. But in the middle of all
time
this...
Time lag.
Yeah. Yeah, it's a thing. So in the middle of this, you realize two things. One, your universal translator is set to SAS. It was, you know, last time you were using it, you were on the run from this planet that was falsely accusing you of crimes against their people, and you forgot to change it back. I mean, you know, with all the explosions and the lasers firing, it was, you know, it's an honest mistake. It happens to anybody, right? Could happen to anybody. And so you have obviously upset this Putin character, and as he goes to open his mouth, right, with this cold-blooded threat, there is this static on the screen, right? And on top of your SAS translator, okay, it would appear that whatever primitive cultures there are on planet Earth at this point in time, they seem to understand radio. Or you know, whatever wireless signal the ship is on, because your communications are being hacked! And then there is this very good-looking guy with a strong jaw and his hair combed back wearing a nicely clipped suit. And it's not Putin at all. He says, sorry about that. He was an asshole. Hi.
Hi. Do I speak to you about Rest on the Bears?
You can talk to me about anything, honey. This is the United States of America, the most powerful and most amazing place on Earth. And he smiles at the camera, and there is that bling of his freshly brushed teeth. And he says, if you want to talk about bears, you and I, we are free to talk about bears. Where are you from, horse-looking space mama?
Well, first off, I'm not a mama, I'm a boy.
Hey, I don't judge. It is your life, you live it how you want, especially if you visit America. Bling!
I'm actually from Dalcetti.
Where's that?
About 2,000 light years that way.
Oh. You've come a long way to get your communications spared the problems of talking to those assholes. How can I help you? What are you here for?
Well, we're looking for some creatures. They kind of got like cybernetic implants, and they like to eat brains.
Well, if you're coming here in hopes of exterminating a threat, I assure you, the United States of America is the best thing that could have ever happened to you. Bling! If there is one thing that stops brain-eating cybernetic implant bad guys, it's bombs. And if there's one thing we've got in America, bling! Other than freedom. And hamburgers. It's bombs.
Can I ask, what's wrong with your teeth? They keep shining.
It's a very serious condition. Bling!
Well, if you have bombs, I'm sure our engineer would actually love to talk to you, because she loves blowing things up, even though she doesn't mean to do it half the time.
What sort of facility or environmental circumstances, techno babble, blah blah blah, I'm certain there's something going on. If you would like to land on the surface, how do we get you down here so we can talk about this in detail?
I'm sure our pilot can just land us, and we should be able to breathe the air.
I'm going to warn you, there are some places on this planet that you should not be flying through in the air. They get very defensive of their territory. That was a joke.
Uh,
But I'm certain we can work something out. How about I shoot you some coordinates?
Sure, I'll mark them on my map.
All right. And he'll shoot you some coordinates, right? And he says, I'm looking forward to seeing you soon. Bling! America out! Click.
And now, when he hangs up, is Putin still there with the mean
face?
Nah,
it's over. Putin missed his chance to be first contact.
All right, so I'm gonna turn back around and go get the coordinates. Maximilian, here's the coordinates where we're supposed to land. They're supposed to meet us. Though there's something wrong with that guy's teeth.
Well, thank you, Victor boy.
So, he does. You do the mod things?
That's all. That's pilot.
Yeah. All right. So I'm gonna say that that Earth during these days had a very different atmosphere, historically speaking. So while your ship is equipped to handle this, because it is equipped to scout any and all planets it might come across in its exploration of what is normally just space, but is now time, I'm going to ask you to roll me lasers to land this puppy. I'm going to say you are an intrepid pilot. This is definitely your area of expertise. So
I botch because of storm spec.
Do you really botch because of storm spec?
I botch because of storm spec.
This game is going to be fucking awesome, I can already tell. All right. So okay, so sparks whiz bang.
Crash.
Crash whiz bang. Oh, how appropriate. As the pilot, as our intrepid pilot, hold on, let me see if I can I do this? All right, you get the lead, you gotta get the gangsta lean. Alright, you get the gangsta lean in your spaceship, alright? You kinda. All right.
Is this shit bouncing on its rims as we try to land?
Yes! So it's got like thrusters on the front of the nose and on the top and just make it go. It's all the rage among the new pilots, right? See, and so they are, and you're just like, yeah, landing. And one of those fucking engines. Yeah, I just made this plot relevant. Fuck you, Zamek. I'm good at this, all right? One of those things. It happens to be the, You know, Crash, you've got that they call it an intelligent watch, right? And it's got you connected to all the systems of the ship, right? And there's this thing going on with one of those thrusters on the front nose, right? And like what is going on? Like, oh, this thing again?
What the hell are they doing down there?
You know, it doesn't matter how many times you tell people not to insert the power cell with the negative side facing in. They just insistently, don't they know anything about the technological properties of plutonium? This is awful. This is terrible.
Idiots.
You know, this is so simple. Idiots, every last one of them. And so you march your ass down there. Right? And so you go in and you throw open the panel and you grab the wires and you start fixing all the things and it explodes!
Yay!
And so it explodes! The ship starts spinning out of control! And the ship is whirling and spinning and leaving a trail of smoke in the atmosphere of ancient Earth, and you're going to crash land in this giant
ship. This is awesome!
This is awesome! Right? And so as the ship is spiraling and spinning out of control, you know, you're looking out the window there, you know, plucking your eyebrows, look at the window, and oh, the ship is spinning, whatever, you continue plucking, right? And then all of a sudden there is this giant green woman with a crown, and your ship goes flying directly into whatever strange alien species this is. Boom! There's an explosion and wreckage everywhere. She's apparently made of stone or some kind of metal, right? And as pieces of the ship go sailing through the atmosphere, smoking trails behind them as they land in the water of the ocean. Sploosh, sploosh. And all of a sudden, there's screaming and chaos as the natives below are going crazy! To find out what happens next, you're gonna have to stay tuned, baby, because it's top of the hour. 3 to 5 minute break. Who can man the guns?
I'll be here.
I'm Evil Squeegee! That's Zang Mac, Magic Mystic, Mr. Jonable, Pyromancy, playing Lasers and Feelings, baby! And currently, the Raptor, our totally not the Enterprise scout ship, has crashed into the fucking Statue of Liberty after having gone way back in time to ancient primitive Earth. Looking for the cyber zombies. Now, in the wreckage, everything kind of settles down. The ship is kind of like swaying back and forth, right? And you look down and you can see all these ancient gas-powered wheeled vehicles. Vehicles still stuck on the ground. They haven't figured out. Have they even invented the plane yet? What's going on? Right?
Scrubs.
And you know, there's all this chaos and stuff going on down you know, in the crowd that is built up. A fucking spaceship just crashed into the Statue of Liberty, right? You guys don't know that. All you see is like flashing lights and alarms and military units and everything like pouring in, right? What?
I'm still looking in my mirror and making sure that I'm looking pristine.
All right.
I'm kind of trying to regain my balance. I couldn't, with the rocking of the ships, you know, hooves don't quite grip the floor really well, so right. I was sliding all over the place. And
you gotta make yourself some cleat hooves or something.
Probably.
Well,
I'm not used to the gravity here, so, like, I kind of, like, just slumped right over, and I'm trying to stand up again and, you know, brush off the soot from the explosion. But that was a pretty good explosion.
That was a pretty good explosion.
Yeah, I'm pretty impressed with myself.
Bing bong. Hey guys, it looks like we've landed.
No kidding.
Some landing.
So I'm gonna. I will make my way up to the bridge.
Yeah.
And I'm gonna walk, like, as I walk into the bridge, I'm sure, like, there's fires and smoke and stuff, and I'm just gonna be like, Maximilian, how's it going? That was a fantastic landing. Hey, Victor. Why are you on the floor?
Because somebody can't fly the stupid plane. Ship.
Don't judge him. Plane is the word for it in his native tongue, okay?
Where the hell are we?
I don't know. It according to the maps, it looked like Earth, and we were supposed to go meet this one guy. He had this really weird thing with his teeth going bling all the time. I don't know. I don't even know if we're in the right spot right now, because somebody just, like, go crashing into things. It was probably the engineer's fault blowing something up.
At this point, I'm going to walk in and be like, look, excuse me, I was trying to fix the problem that you guys started, and then it exploded. But you know what? I'm sorry. It was kind of cool. It was pretty awesome. And I'm still kind of slumped over because gravity.
That's funny. Oh, sorry. Was you guys talking?
What? Looney Tunes, motherfucker. It's important shit.
Oh, yeah. Looney Tunes.
Somehow it still works.
Yeah. The little TV on his control panel.
I'll be a little annoyed thinking that that's the reason why we crashed with the Looney Tunes, and I'll probably take my hooves and I'll kick the screen.
What's up?
You know, if you weren't watching that, we probably would have landed in one piece.
Don't make me take you to the stables.
Wow. That's cold. So, as you guys are kind of like filtering out and having your typical crew banter back and forth, the crowd down below you, right? Which initially was just, you know, sirens and wailing and so on and so forth, right? Has actually started screaming.
Oh, it's our welcome party. We have some fans.
Like, scattering and panicking. Not in the sense that, like, oh, somebody's crashed into a giant green person on our planet, but, like, something else seems to be going wrong, and you can't quite make it out here because they're all like little ants from up here.
So wait, are we like stuck on top of the Statue of Liberty right now?
Yeah, okay, so the Statue of Liberty, like this, right? Just remove the head and replace it with a spaceship.
That's pretty cool, actually.
Yeah.
I like the modifications.
So do I.
Oh, then.
Oh. I guess at that point, I'll make my way, like, to the hatch or something to see if we can't, like, get down or something.
Get down!
Should we maybe not try to, like, talk to them first and be like, we come in peace, or...
Why? We were invited.
That's a good point.
That's true.
I'm gonna go and like, is there like an external intercom, like, so I can like maybe put my face on display, like to the people below?
Yeah, why not? Sure.
So I'm gonna go over and I'm gonna put it that like push the button side. Hey, I'm Randy. Don't worry, no panic. I'm here to impregnate your women and perform science. Sometimes, just the impregnation. You think that should do it? Yeah, that'd be good.
I'm all out of science.
They feel just great about that. Yep.
Roll me. I'm gonna say that this is not your expertise. Clearly, and I'm also gonna say
I was prepared.
You were prepared. You are. Gorgeous right now, honey. You are gorgeous. All right, so roll me 2d6. All right, and this is gonna be a feelings thing. So you're looking to roll over your number. Two successes. You succeed.
Two successes.
You succeed without a hitch. Now, what was your intent here? Was it like to calm everybody down, or
yeah.
Okay.
And you know, willing victim, partners.
Are you willing?
Willing victim, volun partners. that is a beat being called for Zangmac, alright? So you get +1 beats. Alright. You know what I'm gonna do? I'm gonna say whoever has the most beats at the end of the show is going to get a benefit. Like a perk for the next one shot they're in. Okay? So there's this is let the competitions for entertaining the audience begin. All right, so Zangmac, keep track, you got one, okay? Now, so what's going on down below, right? The screaming and the panicking doesn't stop in the immediate sense, all right? But what I will say is that the ship is suddenly slammed, not physically, but technologically, by a huge barrage of incoming calls that dwarfs the number of calls that came in when you were just popping out of the tunnels and into orbit, alright? So, whatever is going on, alright, you have clearly gotten the attention of a lot of people, right? Some of them had little, you know, like, icons, you know, the very particular angles on the selfies taken for, like, the blue box with the F means, whatever, but they're hot, that's the important part, alright? And,
sexy aliens.
And, I mean, to you, they're aliens, because these are ancient primitive earthlings. And so, like, there is this barrage of just, like, people technologically throwing themselves at your feet, right? But in the middle of all this, there is, in fact, some sort of, like, starting to get a little, like, the crowd is starting to... Some of them are dying down there. They're starting to get pretty bloody.
What did you do?
I'm just gonna point at Crash.
Excuse me, I cause explosions, I don't cause people to bleed. Disintegrate, maybe.
They look like they're exploding to me.
Well, then maybe you should get your sexy eyes checked. That is not the problem.
Thank you for that compliment.
Oh, good. I make people explode, not bleed? Oh, okay.
Well,
I'm assuming probably by now, I would probably reach the hatch for the ship to see if we can't get down.
Oh, you can get down. You open the loading bay. With the hydraulic beams and the smoke and the sparks. And it opens up almost conveniently down to this staircase. It would seem that inside the giant green person, there is a stairwell that leads down.
I'll open up the little communicator and tell him, hey, there's something wrong with this person. They're hollow inside.
Crawling in my skin! These wounds, they will not heal! No,
And then then I just start going down the stairs to go see what's going on.
I'm walking behind him, but my communicator is a bit modified and it's got Looney Tunes on it.
Alright, so the party starts like filing down the stairs?
Well, I'm gonna turn to the engineer.
Yep.
Stairs? Don't we have a transporter over there?
Yeah, but I don't know if it's a good idea to use it after everything exploded. I mean, if you want to explode, that's...
You, I'll try it. Oh, yeah. And I'll go stand in, wait for her to teleport me down.
All right, then. Don't say I didn't warn you.
All right.
And I'm going to be stood there, like, hands on hips with, like, the bling smile giving it, like... Yeah.
Oh, right. He's going to turn into a sexy mist.
All right, so... a sexy red mist. What I want you to do... What I want you to do, Crash Whizbang, the dangerous engineer, I want you to roll me lasers to operate the malfunctioning teleportation device.
So I roll a...
You're going to roll 2d6. This is your expertise, and you get one base. However, you're not prepared for this. You didn't take any actions that prepare you for this whole scenario, and you're trying to get a 2 or lower on each die.
I got one lower.
If one die succeeds, you barely manage it. The GM inflicts some complication, harm, or cost. All right! So, Randy! These teleportation devices, fantastic piece of technology. Genius, really. All right? They disassemble you, move your molecules, and then reassemble you. Old technology that did similar things would actually just, like, it would destroy you but save the data to create a new version of you. And people eventually decided that it was a little creepy talking to a replica rather than the original person, so they eventually found a workaround. The problem is that sometimes if things go wrong like this, so you're going to pop out with two heads that don't like each other. That's my complication for you.
Is one going to be sexy and one not going to be
sexy?
Oh,
they're both very sexy.
Oh, okay.
The only thing they can agree on is how sexy they really are.
And on that note, they're going to turn to each other and be like, damn. Oh. Let's get to it. No. I'm going back. No. We're going to go impregnate. No. Science. I have a...
What? What have you done, Screechy?
What have I unleashed upon the world? Holy shit, this is a terrible idea. Let's do it! Alright, so... I'm seeing okay, there was a beat for, it's gotta be more than one person calling beat. It really does need to be more than one person calling beat, alright? But so... Alright, well, the teleportation seems to have gone through, as far as you can tell on this end.
Alright, guys, he made it. Let's go.
Do you go down the stairs? You take the teleporter.
Oh, I'm taking the teleporter. I can't tell that he has two heads. So...
Alright, why don't you roll me another 2d6?
Shit.
Oh god. She dies.
If none of your dice succeed, it goes wrong. The GM says how things get worse somehow. Alright, so.
If you bring me back up, I'm not going to be impressed.
All right, so the teleportation device is supposed to find like a safe area where there's nothing around, right? The teleportation device will actually just send you to the wrong location. All right, and you step in, you hit the buttons, beep, boop, boop, beep, boop, boop, beep, and it explodes!
Yay!
Goes the explosion, and your character will be teleported over the crowd. Not into the crowd, not on the ground, in the air. All right.
Well, that seemed to... Ah!
So Randy. Randy Spacebook. And Randy Spacebook. There you are. Impregnate. No, science. No, impregnate. Right. And all of a sudden, there is a fireball in the middle of the air. An explosion. And there is Crash Whizbang popping out of the explosion like launched through the air. And she is going to land and potentially truly hurt herself if you do not do anything, because the others took the stairs. This is going to, however, require that you run into the panicked, dying crowd.
Oh, does it?
Yes.
Are you sure?
Why do you ask if I'm the GM is supposed to be the one who says, are you sure?
Because I want to set my phaser to love.
Okay.
Attractor beam.
Attractor beam. Ah!
So I want to set it to love.
Right.
So that it envelops her in like a cushioning warm embrace.
Is this a laser or a feeling? I can't tell. Roll me!
It's halfway either way.
We're gonna say that this is I'm gonna call it feelings. Fuck it, alright? You can set your phases to love, and you can pull her in with your attractor beam.
One dice, right?
Are you an expert in attractor beams?
I'm going to say one die because you're not prepared for this. You didn't take any actions that would lend themselves to helping here. And, you want to roll over your number! Yay! Alright, so you are sailing towards the ground, Crash Whizbang, and you are going to get caught. Like, suddenly you're just going to stop falling. And you start smelling candles. Is that Barry White you hear? And as the slow, jazzy, as the machine starts to, and you will be gently dropped into the arms of Randy Spacebuck. He's never looked so good. Two heads! Ah! Which one? Oh, can you even choose?
So, Crash,
this is like
now that I...
my dream come true.
This is your dream come true.
I was gonna go along with something there, but that's really okay.
Oh god, I love this game! Alright, so your two heads both found a single person.
Perhaps now, Crash, that I know. We know, I know. You're here. Perhaps you could settle something.
Okay.
Is he more good looking? Or am I more good looking?
I can't decide! You saved me! I think I'm in love.
I have often suspected as such. It's in the feelings.
Quick!
The other head's going to disagree. It's all science. Yeah.
I can't fucking handle you assholes. So, while the starry-eyed lovers, while Crash falls for Randy.
Spacebuck.
While this is going on, very distracted by each other suddenly. Okay, so Maximilian Pegasus and Victor Cool. Victor, stairs are very difficult for you. In the future, everybody uses ramps. They're so much more efficient, effective, sturdy, less prone to tripping. Why steps? Why? 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 So there you are, muttering to yourself, coming down the steps. Clop, clop, clop. Clop, 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 clop. With Maximilian stoically coming down the stairs after you, or before you, at some point.
Oh, money shot.
That is tech. You give me $10 saying, botch for evil squeegee. Looks like your dreams come two. I get two botches. Aw.
Except as the DM, you don't use dice.
I don't use dice. However, she is allowed to save those and put those on other characters for the games or something, I guess. But I don't.
Yep.
I don't do it. So, you're coming down the stairs as your unicorn alien self with your Looney Tunes watching pilot. And as you reach the bottom floor, like some sort of like museum or altar or whatever strange primitive people did inside of giant green people on Earth, who knows? And you walk through the front doors, and there is Crash, and there is Randy. You don't remember him having two heads, but more importantly, as they are staring. Or rather, like, you ever had, like, when two people are, like, or when three people are trying to go through a door at the same time, there's that moment, right? Imagine that, but, like, with people trying to lock eyes with each other in this romantic moment, because you never know who's supposed to be looking, like, Randy is trying to look at Randy, and Randy's trying to look at, yeah, and there's all this, like, they don't know what they're doing, but they're so distracted trying to do this that they don't notice that the bodies of the people in the crowd that were dying are beginning to jerkily stand up around them. And the dead rise again and begin to crawl towards them, distracted, eager to consume the flesh of the living. What do
Why
you do?
Why does this always happen when I'm in a game with you?
What? Zombies?
Zombies.
Have you met me?
Have you met me? Like, I don't...
Yes! Yes, I did. I met you at PAX East.
That's right, yeah. But anyway, zombies are not my thing. I don't like them. And I feel like you're doing this on purpose.
That's right, yeah. Get over it. Now that you mentioned it, I'll do this deliberately next time! Alright, so, cyber zombie. For the record, you can thank Sky Captain 13. He's the one who... no, I'm sorry. You can thank the dice. The dice selected cyber zombies. So the cyber zombies are crawling towards them! But they don't notice because the starstruck lovers are too busy trying to figure out whose eyes should be staring into whose. What do you do, Maximilius? Victor?
Well, how close are one of these zombies getting to both of them?
If you don't do something in the next, like, say, 5 seconds, they're probably going to get eaten.
Well, I'm going to take one of my hoofs, and since you said they're crawling, I'm going to take one of my feet and just stomp on the head.
Are you telling me you would like to yump on the zombie?
Yes, I will yump on a zombie.
All right, that is going to be a laser action.
Well, I would. But I botched thanks to Serapy.
Well, because Serapy has decreed that you botch, you shall botch. Ka-ka-dum, ka-ka-dum, ka-ka-dum. You'll launch yourself into a gallop and you'll come sailing over them in this dramatic, you know, like the dramatic horse sailing over the Star Trek lovers with your unicorn horn and you're leaving rainbows in your wake as you sail to the... And then you're going to land on the zombie. The thing is that zombies are not flat, right? Everything on this planet is just not friendly for you. Like, The ancient past was terrible and inconsiderate, and zombies are not flat, and you're going to bot, you're going to hit the ground, you're going to land on it and trip and be like, what? Shut down! And hit the ground, okay? And as you hit the ground, you will successfully distract from the other two being eaten. However, this is only because, well, unicorn meat is delicious. And so there you are, like, on your side, having tripped and screwed the landing, right? And a horde of cyber zombies are crawling all over you! This is enough to break the Star Trek lovers. There is a... Can you... Do me a favor. I need you to roleplay something for me, Pyro. You are a Swedish unicorn, correct? Alright? You are being attacked by a horde of zombies. Probably like this, whatever, right? But what does this sound like? The panicked and pained screams of a man who is Swedish and also a unicorn and not a man at all.
No! No! Stop taking over me! Stop!
Thank you very much, Pyromancer. I appreciate that. Very good. Bravo! This is the man you can look forward to GMing every Wednesday night at 8 p.m. starting the 24th on twitch.tv/pyromancy. So, Starstruck Love. Actually, you know what? I haven't gotten anything out of Maximilian Pegasus, the intrepid pilot, whose goal is to keep being awesome. How do you keep being awesome in this scenario, Maximilian?
I set my phaser to Looney Tunes.
All right.
And when it makes the shooting noises, it sounds like an anvil dropping from Looney Tunes.
Mm-hmm.
And it actually drops anvils on people's heads.
All right. So you want to drop anvils on cyber zombies?
Yes.
All right. I'm going to say that you have been playing out this Looney Tunes thing this whole time. You are prepared. All right? You've been getting in the mood for some anvil dropping, right? So you flip through your phaser settings and you find the dial on Looney Tunes. Right where you like it. And, and there you go. Beep, boom, roll it. That's gonna be two dice. Fearlessly anvil dropping on cyber zombies. That was a laser. You're looking to roll under your number. What's your number again?
Four.
Two successes, you nail it. All right, so these anvils come sailing, materializing out of the sky. You're actually aiming it like this. You don't aim it at the zombies.
Yeah.
You aim it like up in the air, right? So you're like, beep, 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 beep. And there is that. A whole horde of, can everybody do that whistle for me? Can we get like the, well, I want this to sound like it. Ready? 3, 2, 1. And all the Zeds, I mean zombies, well, fucking my life, bro. They're not Zeds, they're zombies. I hate everything about Killing Floor right now. Well, you know, the clang, 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 clang. They're all labeled Acme.
I am just laughing.
And you are laughing and laughing. What about the others? That is doing a real dent on the number of cyber zombies, but he hasn't strictly solved the problem. There's still the cyber zombies on top of the unicorn. He couldn't drop anvils on those because he would also crush the unicorn, but he's gotten all the extras. So what are you guys doing? How do you save that unicorn?
Well, now that I'm no longer, you know, staring lovingly at Randy, I'm going to set my phasers to explode. Explode?
Explode.
Explode.
Because right. I need to retry. All
right. Oh. I need to, okay, so it's the Star Trek lover's turn, and crash whiz bang, the dangerous engineer has set her phasers to explode.
Explode. I was trying to do like explode plus explode.
Is that anything like Doge?
Doge.
Explode. Yeah, I don't know. Much fire, many blow up. Wow.
But yeah, I'm going to set them to explode. And I'm going to start shooting at zombies.
All right.
Probably closest to the unicorn. I'm sorry.
Roll me lasers.
So that's 2d6, right?
1d6. I will. It's not your expertise. I'll say the exploding fetish calls you prepared. So roll me 2d6. Yeah. Roll me 2d6. And you're looking to get 2 or lower.
Under a 2. God damn it.
Yeah, under a 2. Oh, but you will get laser feelings! You will fail. but you will get laser feelings, all right? So, you get to ask me a question. You can ask me, what are they really feeling? You can ask me, who's behind this? You can ask me, how can I get them to blank? You can ask me, what should I be on the lookout for? Or you can ask me, what's the best way to blank? Or, what's really going on here?
How can I get the zombies to stop trying to eat my unicorn friend?
That is the best sentence that has ever been uttered by anybody on the internet in the history of anything. So how can what is the best way to do that? Cyber zombies, once they catch the scent of prey, never stop. You have to either destroy them such that they can no longer move, such that they can no longer sense their prey. All right, or you can hack them and shut them down.
Ooh.
So in short, in review, you can hack the world, go for the eyes, boo, or chop off their legs.
Wait, I have one more question. Can you change the scent of the prey so that they no longer smell like prey?
You're an engineer. You have no idea how biology works. No.
Okay. I would like to hack the zombies.
All right, hack the world it is.
Yay.
You get to reroll your action, right?
So 2d6 again?
Give me 2d6.
Okay.
You're aiming for under 2.
I got it.
All right. I've already given you laser feelings on this action, so I'm going to go ahead and say I'm not going to do the rerun of it, all right? But you're going to start hacking the zombies, right? And what's going to happen is you grab your phaser, right? And you start hacking away, doing the beep, boop, 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 beep, 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 angrily staring into your phone. You're going to save this unicorn, right? And you cast a cyber net over the cyber zombies, like this light kind of like launches forth from your device as you establish connections with the processing units inside the cyber zombies. And then your phone, which you are using to hack the zombies, they're going to get the upper hand. And in the tug of war that we all know Hollywood's interpretation of hacking is, you can't hack fast enough. They're so fast. They've got your phone. Your phone is leaping out of your hand and attacking your face. Ah! All right, Randy, what are you doing?
I want to perform an experiment.
All right, time for science.
It's time for some science.
All right, let's do some science, baby. What do you got for me?
The zombies aren't attacking other zombies, are they?
To do science, you need a hypothesis.
I'm
okay.
Verbalizing.
Okay, we're verbalizing. All right. All right. So
the zombies are not attacking other zombies.
No, they aren't.
So, therefore, they must either not care about their own, or simply not be aware of their own.
Okay.
Therefore, I'm gonna make Victor a zombie suit.
All right.
Whereas my head of love, we'll be administering zombie guts lovingly to Victor. That's the theory and the practical.
All right. So theory and practical, and you want to make a zombie. So roll me lasers. I'm gonna say that this is your realm of expertise because you are the scientist, and this is science. So give me 2d6. You want lower. What's your number? 3?
That is one success.
That is one success, so there will be a complication, okay? I am not sorry at all. So, in order to pass as a cyber zombie, you're gonna need 2 things. Dead flesh and cybernetics. Now, thankfully, you have both an ample supply, because your captain just smashed a whole ton of cyber zombies by setting his phaser to Looney Tunes and dropping anvils on everybody. So, away you go, collecting all the pieces and parts for an effective zombie, cyber zombie cosplay. A cyber no, it's not a cyber Cosby. I should rethink this one. So we are headed in the direction of you slathering all this. You're kind of like ducking around the zombies that are like crawling over him. And what does this sound like again? Can you refresh my memory, Victor?
No, shut up, come to me!
No!
And you're smearing the stuff all over him, right? And then his mouth is open, so into his horse mouth, like, you stuff some cybernetics, right? And right? And you start, like, draping wires and stuff on him, all right? And you will succeed.
So when I step back...
You step back, right?
I shall call him Unicron.
Donables just gave up. Donables just quit. I can see it in his eyes. There's no more hope left. His faith in humanity is gone. You murdered it brutally.
God damn it.
That'll be a beat for Zangmag. Looks like I'm seeing it starting to blow up in chat. So, here's the thing. You succeed. In your intent to protect the unicorn from the cyber zombies, you disguised the unicorn as a cyber zombie. But there's a complication. Your disguise is too effective. Ultimately speaking, you did not disguise him as a cyber zombie. You've made him into one. And so the unicorn rises to a standing position on all four newly zombified hooves. And when he opens his mouth to say his first words as a cyber zombie, circuit boards and silicone spill from his mouth like so much blood. And he says,
"Yum bun you for brains."
And he leaps forward! Roll those lasers for me, unicorn!
Is that gonna be a 1 or a 2?
What's your number?
5.
5? Okay, if lasers is under, you wanna roll... I'm gonna say that you are prepared, because you are Unicron. I'm also gonna say, what was your role on the ship? You were the alien, and your role was...
Explorer.
But
as I'm looking at this, if I'm reading the sheet right, I botched. But thanks to you, me.
Jump on you for brains. And he leaps at you, right? Except for there's all this blood on the ground, so when he goes to leap, he slips and he falls flat on his face again. What are you doing?
To the stables.
I'm pointing, like, both heads are pointing at each other. That was his fault.
Am I still being attacked?
Not by the cyber zombies. They're confused at the moment.
They're like, what?
So then I'm not in any immediate danger anymore, right?
Well, I mean, other than the fact that there's still a bunch of cyber zombies like 10 feet away, yes.
You but just they're have not, like, actively attacking me anymore.
They will shortly if you don't do something about it.
Can I retry setting my phasers to explode and shooting them again now that they're distracted?
Yes.
Okay. Because, goddammit, I'm going to get an explosion in.
You may attempt that again. Roll me lasers.
1 or 2?
This is your expertise?
Lasers? Or
And you are prepared this time. Because now, when your phaser tried to attack you, you wrestled it down and you fixed it, but now you've seen the code. So I'm going to say you're prepared this time. Roll me 3d6.
Ooh, okay. I have a partial success, I believe.
You have a partial success and a laser feeling. What question would you like me to answer?
Who's behind this? What caused these people to suddenly turn into cyber zombies when we landed?
All right. So, an answer to your question is you're looking at the code. All right. The first answer is neither. Neither of Randy's heads is responsible for this.
Well, I figured as much.
Not one of the three.
I get it.
Wah, 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 dick joke. All right, so. But you can see in the code, and you can see through it, and you can read it. This is what you do, and you begin to understand. The cyber zombies came through the tunnel with you, and they reached the most populated place that they could. With their virus riding upon your ship, now released into the air in this local area, that's why they're right here. Who's in charge of them? Well, it would seem that the greatest of the intelligences, of the artificial intelligence of the cyber zombies, have just downloaded themselves into that unicorn. He is the cyber zombie king unicorn. And you understand their goal. They don't want to just infect the past. They want to infect the past and then reverse the polarity of the quantum tunnel to launch themselves back into the future with a virtually endless army. The consortium would never survive such an attack. You have to stop this today.
Randy, you are sexy as hell, but this is kind of your fault.
I know.
All right. You get a partial success, all right? And you will hack the zombies, right? And they will be forced staggering back and away from you, right? Ah! Brains! No! Brains! And Victor. Victor Cool, you will be driven back as if by some technological equivalent of a turn undead. And you will be forced to flee into the chaos and the crowds and the traffic and the map of New York City. What do you say as you run away?
Brains otherwhere. Going to go jump on shore.
So there he goes. Escaping you. But. It would seem that you are safe. At least for now. Free to concoct some kind of space plan to stop the cyber zombies. You have at your disposal an endless reel of every episode of Looney Tunes ever released. The Raptor and its armory. Very powerful engines. Very fast ship, very powerful engines. If only Captain Darcy was with us right now, he'd know what to do. But it would seem that it is up to our intrepid pilot, our sexy scientist, and our dangerous engineer to come up with some sort of plan that will save planet Earth and thus the universe. Immediately. Both of Randy's heads start arguing about what the best plan is. What are their two propositions?
We should try to reach into his inner self, his true being, and draw him out. That's complete bollocks. He's taken over. We should destroy the technology. But love will conquer all. Feelings will work.
Did you pick up Titanius?
Yes! Yes, he did!
On one thing we can agree, I'm gonna look damn good doing it. And they nod.
Alright, what of the others? There are two plans here. We destroy the technology, thus preventing the spread of the cyber zombie plague, or we try and draw our good old unicorny friend out from somewhere deep down in the depths of that artificial intelligence mind controlling him and making him evil.
I vote for whichever plan has more explosions.
I think killing him would have more explosions.
Then I vote for that.
Thank you, Mystic. Thank you.
Well, Pyromancy, I don't know what you're expecting. We brought you into the one shot. These are the people you've been botching and screwing with Destiny tokens for a month and a half at least.
Bear in mind, I also have a habit of killing other people that I happen to be playing with, so.
It's true.
Like Sabingury, yes.
You know, I can't not do that. Then you guys would think I'm not me.
She's the cyber zombie.
Well, Maximilian Pegasus. As standing captain, the decision is ultimately yours.
This is a lot like the Looney Tunes episode I was watching earlier.
What was going on in that Looney Tunes episode?
Meep meep.
Alright, so what wisdom can you draw from the ancient spiritual animations of ancient Earth?
Should blow it up with a rocket.
And thus, the plan is concocted. Maximilian Pegasus settles the debate. I'm sorry, Randy, but we're gonna have to use Randy's plan.
I have but one request. We have but one request. We need some of that teeth shine bling.
That serious condition, I believe he called it.
That is key to any plan.
Alright, so Maximilian Pegasus describes to the engineer the rocket that must be built. Time is of the essence. For if you take too much time, the cyber zombie plague will spread. Cyber zombie plague will spread. And it will be so much more difficult, as any one cyber zombie could just become the new housing for the main core of the intelligence, becoming the cyber zombie king. You know you can identify the king on sight now. This is an advantage you cannot release. You must act quickly. Meanwhile, cyber zombie king, Victor Cool, unicorn from outer space. God, that is the coolest fucking sentence. You are unleashed into the streets of New York City. What do you do? Your goals include raising an army, eating brains, and scaring the shit out of people.
Well, of course, I'm going to be eating everyone's brains that I see and infecting them as I go.
Okay. Where do you go?
Well, I remember as we were landing that it looked like above there was this big giant square area that had a lot of people in it. I'm going to head there. To go start
with the flashing, signs and the obnoxious people in costumes that smell like pee harassing tourists. Yes, you go to Times Hexagon. Wait, no, Times Square. If your historical knowledge serves you, and the Cyber Zombie King, now armed with all of the information that he could have had about ancient Earth, heads to what he believes is the center of all. Tourism. And as...
Lots of brains.
As the cyber zombie unicorn king heads to Times Square in hopes of increasing his army, and our heroes begin building a bomb, the weight of murdering their fellow friend and longtime crew member, probably not on their shoulders in the slightest, because they're all sociopathic fucks and Herbermotos in disguise. The point is...
I'm actually looking at reflections of myself and myself.
We leave these heroes for but a moment, because to discover what happens next as we prepare for the final confrontation with the cyber zombies who wish to reverse time by taking over the quantum tunnel. We're gonna have to take 3 to 5 minutes here, because it is top of the fucking hour, baby. All right.
Yo.
Alright, welcome back. Twitch.tv/EvilSqueegee. Today we're playing Lasers and Feelings as the launch... As the pilot episode of One Shot Sundays. Alright. And it's gonna be awesome. So here's the deal. Alright? Here's the deal. Pyromancy. You are an explorer of the universe. An alien from outer space. A unicorn. And you have been infected with the hive mind of the cyber zombie plague. And you are currently running around through ancient Earth. You have arrived here through a time portal. You are infecting Times Square with all of the cyber zombie you can. Meanwhile, the rest of you are trying to build a rocket. So, what I'm going to ask you guys to do is round the table, Who is contributing what to the rocket-building shenanigans?
I am making sure that all of the weapons are set to full explosion levels.
Yes, you are making certain that the explosionosity is set to maximum capacity.
Indeed.
I'm making sure it's able to pilot itself to its location.
Okay.
And I'm going to make sure the explosion itself only affects the technological part of the unicorn.
You're going to make it.
We work so well together, Randy.
You're going to give it an explosion of EMP and explosive, magnificent phallus.
Yes. Exactly that.
Especially coming from Randy Facebook. Oh yeah, we're having a giveaway, guys. If we have 30 retweets, we're gonna have a giveaway. It'll be awesome. Alright, so now to make it self-piloting is gonna be a laser's role. I'm gonna say this is you are an expert in piloting, so I'll give you that. Alright, but you are not prepared for this, so give me 2d6 to see if you can make the rocket self-piloting. Did you roll under your number?
No, but I got lasers.
All right, laser feelings. You can ask me one of these questions here that's right on the map. Right here.
How did I get them to autopilot?
You could make it home in on the technological aspects, the circuitry. All circuitry gives off an electric signal of some kind. You could attune this missile to that circuitry, but you're going to have to get close enough to the circuitry to capture the electric signal it has without getting converted yourself.
I go back and watch Green the Tunes.
All right, and then Crash Whizbang, the dangerous engineer played by Imagining Mystic, what are you doing? And to set explosion, you know what, you really truly love explosions. This is something you are absolutely passionate about. I will let you roll feelings.
Okay.
To make this missile explode even
so
more.
So how many am I rolling?
You're gonna roll 1d6 base plus 1d6 expertise, but you are also not prepared. So it's gonna be 2d6, and you're looking to get over a 2.
Over a 2.
Yes, feelings, you want to get over a 2.
Yay!
Full success! Maximum explosionosity achieved!
Yay!
What does this look like, this tinkering for explosions? The face. There you go, Pyromancy. There's a gift for you. Now, Randy! Not you, the other Randy. What are you and your buddy doing? I believe your goal was to make it an EMP. What is it that you plan on doing here with this science? What sort of science are you applying? Where did you learn this science?
This is basic science from the future. An EMP is something that is technologically advanced in this day and age, but in the future, yeah. Things have shielding and such like this, but I imagine that doesn't exist these days, like in this day and age. So, first of all, we catch our reflection in the shell of the rocket.
All right.
And then we apply feeling to this explosion so that it simply fills out the technological elements of the threat. So it's not necessarily a heat explosion, it's an explosion of energy. This energy specifically targets the technology we applied to save our friend from his disastrous situation. We still need the teeth bling.
I thought you said tiefling. I was like, what?
The tiefling.
The teeth bling.
That is critical to this mission.
So why don't you roll me science? To apply future technologies to modern-day materials in an attempt to make a threat-assessing cyborg zombie-hunting EMP explosion.
Yay.
What, one die?
It's gonna be two dice. Because three dice! Three, not two, three, because you are prepared. This is future technology you're applying here. Alright, so what'd you get? Did you get...
One success.
One success? You're looking to get under your number, right? And your number is three? Alright, so, here's the deal. One of you is convinced that something went wrong. The other is convinced that everything went according to plan. However, the one of you that's convinced that something went wrong can't identify what went wrong. What does that look like for the rest of us?
It's just not right. It needs more oomph, more passion, more feeling, and... You're talking madness, man! Madness! This is science! It's technology, it's not love! We know love. Yes, we know love. However, it's still lacking that certain oomph. There's no oomph to technology! Well, actually, yes, there are oomph to certain technologies, but you should probably speak to Crash about that.
So, though you are not sold that your design is perfect, it is as good as you can make it. Now, are you going, pilot, to collect the signature from the cyber zombie plague?
I am.
All right. Now, fearlessly, for you are the intrepid pilot of the Raptor.
Yes.
You must somehow sneak up to Times Square. Following the trail of the Cyber Zombie King is not difficult. He leaves in his wake. Hoofprints.
Of blood.
Hoofprints of blood! And so you follow those bloody hoofprints all the way to this arena of primitive culture, where there are towers, where people would pack themselves into buildings like sardines. And on the outsides of those buildings would be the flashiest, shiniest, animated signs in the first step towards holographic culture projection. But in this case, the masses are brainwashed and impregnated with the corporate king's desires, if the history books are to be believed. And you look and you see images of gorgeous women and ancient earth language on every sign, and there are people clamoring and screaming, and at the center of this intersection of ancient pavement, you see the unicorn zombie king looking over his domain, chewing on brains as he grows his army. You are close enough to get the symbol, but you must remain hidden while you do so. Roll me lasers.
One.
Two. This is not your expertise, but you are prepared. He was your friend. You know him. Thus, you know how to hide from him. Partial success. Yes?
Do you need to get under?
Under.
Then I got complete.
Complete success.
Number's four.
You will remain hidden. How is it that you... What? Do you cause some sort of distraction?
I put Looney Tunes on the big board.
Alright. Victor Cool. Unicorn Cyber Zombie King from outer space. You are sitting at the hub of this primitive Earth's population. There is no greater center of traffic than here. People strangely dressed in flip-flops and khaki shorts and Hawaiian shirts meander along mindlessly like sheep, looking through strange camera-like devices, looking up. They've got hung around their necks while they argue with each other, holding out these strange pieces of paper that you eventually determine are maps. Wearing these garments over their garments that have hieroglyphs that say something about love. You recognize the universal galactic symbol for love in the shape of a heart. And then there are the people wearing tribal costumes of red and blue furry creatures harassing these map-holding lovers of travel and camera-like devices. And you look around, and even as they are doing their tourist thing, they are being descended upon by cyber zombies, and your army grows with every squelchy, crunchy bite of delicious brain flakes, part of this healthy breakfast. And then all of a sudden, all those advertising panels and billboards and signs that reach from the earth to the sky in an impressive display of architectural knowledge for such a primitive race, suddenly they all change to that ancient depiction of the ancient earth god, Roadrunner.
Meep meep.
Gone! It would seem that your foes from the future, the Consortium, taunt you! What do you do?
Well, first, but before that even starts happening, as my little zombie army is devouring the brains, I'm saying, resistance is futile. You will be assimilated. Mm-hmm. Give me your brains and maps.
You begin to download the knowledge of all of New York City. Impressive, what a name.
And then, as the billboards change, I'll look up. Tasty. In reference to the Roadrunner running across.
Mm-hmm.
And then, I'll say, Maximilian. He probably has tasty brains too. And I'll try to look for him.
Whether or not Maximilian has brains is up for debate, however. That said, by the time that you have processed what might be going on, that he might be nearby, Maximilian has cunningly vanished. But you know he was here, for he, as far as you can tell, is the high priest of the ancient earth gods. And only he would know to send you a message through their mouths, their words, the divine will of the Looney Tunes. You have captured the signal, whilst they were unaware of your presence, Maximilian, and you can return to your crew as they finish up the final touches of the anti-cyber-zombie EMP missile of delicious explosions.
Yay!
And with the final touch, you can plug in your phaser and upload the data of the cyber-zombie electronic signal. But first, you must find a suitable place from which to launch your missile. Where do you want to take this roughly bicycle-sized weapon of mass destruction?
The torch of the lady.
I was just going to say that.
Exactly, right? I was like, we need a good vantage point.
And so you take your EMP missile and you hoist it up. It is made, actually, of particularly lightweight materials. Technology in the future was such that one man should be able to move a missile, so you just pick it up in one hand, hold it over your head, and kind of, like, walk up the stairs.
Like a waiter, apparently.
Your EMP, sir.
Randomly has Acme on the side.
Oh, it yep. is. It is. If you are to save the mortals, the primitive ancient humanoids, you might as well disguise it as a gift from their god that you do not tamper too heavily with the ancient past, right? Thus, painstaking detail has been put into the video records of their religious documents, these cartoons that don't have anything to do with cars, nor do they have much of a tune to them. Yes?
ACME stands for Ancient Cartoon Monastery Explosion.
Bravo, ladies and gentlemen, motherfucking Mr. Johnables, that is incredible. I love it. I fucking love it. That's amazing. All right. And so up the great stone green lady. I'm sorry, metal green lady. You go. That is a beat for Johnables. That is a beat for Johnables. All right. And you head on up. And you find yourself looking over the city. The chaos. The death. These people didn't ask for any of this. History is changing. What are the humans of ancient Earth to do without you to save them? They are not prepared for this. They haven't even discovered time travel yet. You hope that perhaps the ancient lineage of any influential individuals that have brought about time travel or the invention of the Raptor or EMPs or any of this are not suffering and dying, thus forever, irrevocably altering the course of the future. Suppose if that is the case, then you have done everything you can, not even knowing if you can return home through that quantum tunnel. That is why the Consortium picked you, Maximilian. Because only you are willing to do what must be done, regardless of the cost. So you sit there, holding the rocket over your head, surveying the skyline of New York City. Magnificent, if primitive. The accomplishments mankind was capable of even before they invented things like floating or robots. Somewhat adds a majesty to the experience of seeing it, knowing that every one of these structures was handmade by actual human beings. And if you are correct, this was in an era after slavery had been abolished, which means that the majority of these buildings would have been built by people who were being paid. The economic brilliance of this system. What an empire. What an empire. Oh, time to throw the bomb.
Woo!
All right, Maximilian, you bomb-tossing fiend. Give me a lasers roll to see how well you throw this sucker.
How many dies?
That's gonna be one.
Does anyone want to help me?
Does what?
I just heard a. Does
anyone want to help me?
can we help?
Everybody yeah. can help him.
Yes.
Everybody
I
roll
like
me a
d6. Help.
If anybody gets this is gonna be a lasers check. So if anybody rolls underneath their number,
I help.
I do not.
All right, so here's the deal, okay? Somehow you're going to help, all right? So how are you helping? Both
of you. Well, they say that two heads are better than one. I now have two heads. So I'm going to be able to line this up with, like, a precision angle for exactly where we're going to be launching it.
You are going to mentally triangulate from multiple perspectives like a true scientist.
Exactly.
All right. Science. Crash whiz bang, how are you distinctly not being of assistance right now? What are you doing that is anything but helpful?
I was going to help him by, like, launching, like, shooting my phaser, which was set to explode, to help him, like, launch it further. But I kind of screwed it up, and it just exploded in my face instead.
Right over! Ah! And with that, somewhat startled, you will throw the bomb. And much like all of its predecessors, as is written in the scripture of the tunes that are loony, as according to your best studies of ancient Earthian, the ancient Earthian litany. As the ancient, what did you call it?
Cartoon monastery.
The
explosion.
Ancient cartoon monastery explosion device falls towards the earth. Can I get another hail of the appropriate and holy sounds? Three, two, one. All right, so the camera will flash over to you, Victor Cool, unicorn from outer space, king of the cyber zombies.
Well, I'm with all the knowledge I've downloaded, I know that there's like satellite dishes and stuff up on top of these big buildings.
Yep.
Well, I my goal is to take over this quantum tunnel, so I'm going to start climbing up one of these buildings to infect the satellite dish and change it to be able to control the tunnel.
Okay, so you, looking down with your cyber zombie enhancements now, you've managed to give yourself not just hooves, but like these things that pop out of your legs, right? Making that they look immediately like, you know, somebody from the 80s might think they were moon boots, but they have these giant claws on the bottom, and you stand up on hind legs, and you pronk, which is that's the name of this motion, you pronk up and plant your paws, your hooves, on the sides of the building, and those boots that you've built yourself with your cybernetic technologies grasp into the side of the building, and you begin to climb. And you climb to the top of this building, and on top is the dish, and as you are just started to climb up, and you begin to see something sailing through the air. It would seem that your enemies are here and they have declared war. You do not have much time.
I'm gonna take my phaser out and set it to rainbow.
You're gonna set your phaser to rainbow and you begin to hack the satellite?
The satellite.
You begin to hack the satellite with your phaser set to rainbow. Primitive, stupid humans. Firewalls and passwords. Their technologies are nothing to those of your people. Where you come from, rainbows are the basis of all. For you have discovered the true truth. All things run on fuel. Nothing is better for fuel than corn. It is where you get the name of your species. All won through corn. You are the unicorn. And with this ancient space wisdom that you have downloaded into your cyber zombie brain from your meager victim, the host of your kingly brain, you hack the satellite, and it begins to fire up a beam that shoots up towards the quantum tunnel, just hovering past Earth. Strangely locked in Earth's orbit. Somehow. Don't ask, it's science. And your beam shoots through the clouds, and it parts them, and it burns its way through the atmosphere, and it collides with the quantum tunnel, and you begin to reverse its polarity, and you begin to hack it with rainbows, and the quantum tunnel is filled with the many colors of corn! I'm gonna flash over the camera, not to our heroes, or our villain, but the ancient cartoon monastery explosion device. And it sinks down and you see it, but it is too late. They may have destroyed your small, meager army here, but the destabilized quantum tunnel, though you have failed in your mission, will surely consume them. Boom! Maximum explosionosity that damages nothing but circuitry. However, the damage is done, though the beam from the satellite has already destabilized the quantum tunnel and begun its polarity to shift and writhe and twist and warp, potentially causing all of time to fall apart at the very seams. The satellite's beam is shut off, its damage done. All of the cyber zombies will collapse in a heap, including you, Cyber Zombie King. Your last thought being, brains. We flash our camera to our heroes. Maximilian! Randy! Crash! Just as your device sails in and the will of the ancient gods is made manifest, the beam fires up from the satellite and you see it slam into the quantum tunnel. Now, Randy, it was you who first suggested perhaps saving Victor Kuhl. You specifically designed this bomb to leave his flesh intact, though he will be very wounded, his body mutilated by the cybernetic implants. They have no power over him anymore. But there is no time. The quantum tunnel is destabilizing. Your friend, if you abandon him, will die. Do you save the universe? Or do you save your friend?
The unicorn.
The universe? Or the unicorn? The choice is yours.
Save the unicorn, save the world.
In that order?
Why not both? We have a transporter.
Quickly! To the ship!
Everybody runs! You do this, aren't you?
Everybody runs into the raptor!
The time communicator, I make the Looney Tunes sound for when they just take off sprinting. I can't do it. Yeah.
Yeah, alright. So you run into the raptor. And with the ancient hymns of the ancient Earth gods playing in the background. Quickly, you begin to work on the control panel. I'm going to need you to roll me two dice. You are rolling lasers, Crash. You are rolling lasers. Roll low and roll true.
Nope. Damn it. I knew this was gonna happen.
Alright. I'm going to say, because we gotta get to the end of this adventure soon, alright, that you do, in fact, manage to teleport Victor Kuhl into the raptor. However, something goes terribly wrong. There is a spark of power, an explosion. Something about the technology just can't withstand the radiation, the temporal radiation from the destabilizing quantum tunnel hovering just above the planet upon which you currently reside. And something goes horribly wrong. There is an explosion of light! Everyone is thrown to their feet! To their butt, upon the ground!
Wait, to our feet! Wait, what?
Thrown to your butt! Ah!
Whoa!
And when the light dies down... Victor Kuhl, you're here. You're awake. You have hands! Crash! Oh, clop, clop. Why do you have hooves?
Wait, I have hooves?
Yes, it would seem that the consciousness of Crash Whizbang has been transported into the body of Victor Kuhl, and the consciousness of Victor Kuhl has been transported into the body of Crash Whizbang. Crash! In Victor's body! Oh, the pain and the agony. Oh, the cybernetics! Oh, they dig into your flesh! Victor! Ancient unicorn technology has been used to destabilize the quantum tunnel. You have the body of the species for which this spaceship was truly designed!
I will set the ship's phasers to rainbows and try to fix the tunnel.
Alright! You're going to have to take this puppy off. In the crash! Aiming this sucker is not possible with the automated systems anymore. You're going to have to do this old school. Pilot! To the cockpit! So glad we both did that! That brings a happiness to my heart that I can barely contain. Alright, so, you're off to the cockpit. What are you doing, sexy Dr. Randy? Sexy doctors?
Can I just say that while all of this is going on, like, I'm trying to pick up my... Because I've had this little phone thing the whole time, right? And it's been my constant companion to my engineering stuff. I'm trying to pick it up with my hoof and crying because I can't.
Can you show me what that looks like? All right.
But hey, at least you got this. You got this.
Crash! Savior of the unicorn?
I'd give you a thumbs up, but I can't.
Alright, so, Dr. Sexy, Dr. Sexy and Dr. Sexy, in these moments, all hands on deck must be on deck. What are you doing?
I'm now confused. Do I now have two people who are interested, or just still one?
Do you wish to discern this? Is that what you wish to spend your time doing?
I wish that Jonawals was not DC'd from Discord.
Oh, no. Well, why don't
but
you...
This is a problem for science and love at another time. I'm going to the cockpit to make it look good. That's what I'm doing.
So you can save the universe.
Someone needs to look good.
Someone needs to be good looking here. Alright. So I need you to roll me feelings. How good looking can you be?
I feel that I have some expertise in this.
You do. Being good looking is in fact what you are an expert in. So roll me... you know what? You also have been preparing for this whole adventure. So roll me feelings. Twice, once for each head.
I think Zhang and I just both got beats, too.
I only see a clot, like, it's gotta be more than one person calling beat.
Yeah, well, Yumi did one, Jen did one, and Sis did one.
Yep, and I'm gonna say that's, let me see, that's... Alright, yep, both of you can take one, that's fine.
Okay, so we're looking at, two dice for each head, or one die per head?
Three dice per head.
Oh, shit.
Because this is an expertise, and you are prepared!
So, that's,
So one of you is busy fucking it up. What about the other one?
It seems my heads are in conflict.
Alright, so, here's the deal, alright? One of your heads is making the sexiest damn face the universe could ever be saved with. The other one is trying... and failing so miserably it actually hurts. So I need you to do this. I want you to juxtapose these two faces and go back and forth for me so the audience could really get an idea of what these two things look like if they were going to be standing next to each other. He's thinking. Right.
That's the pose.
Oh, like, this is your sexy pose?
Yeah, like
introspective. I suddenly can't hear the declaration of your actions over the sound, the roarous thunder of panties, the worldwide hitting the floor.
He's literally focusing on a random panel on the wall and being like,
"All right."
And the other head is like,
"Your chin's getting cut off." All right, now I need to flip between those a couple of times so we can really see what's going on here.
And the hands are actually like moving. Like, between, yeah.
Alright, Power Man, so you know what to do. Thank you, Zhang. Alright, so did I just say the sentence, one of your heads is making the sexiest damn face the universe could ever be saved with? That's quote 700?! Holy shit! Alright, so, I need the unicorn to roll me lasers for unicorn technologies. And I
Wait,
need...
Which
the unicorn?
The unicorn in the babe's body. Alright, and then I need the fearless pilot to fearlessly pilot a lasers roll to aim that technology at the quantum tunnel.
Now, is that one die or two?
I'm gonna say that you are prepared, but it is not your expertise because this isn't your body. So I'll give me two. Does that roll under your number?
That rolls under my number.
Twice or once?
Both times.
All right. And pilot, roll me lasers.
I mean that.
Two, you're not prepared for this, but this is your expertise. You got one, right?
Yeah, one.
One partial success? All right. So, ladies and gentlemen, the fate of the universe hangs in the balance. The quantum tunnel is destabilizing. The zombie plague has been defeated. However, our heroes are approaching their fated destinies. The universe is going to implode, unless proper application of universal corn technology can restabilize it. Our expert in technology is sobbing, staring at her hooves, afraid that perhaps she has been cursed with the world's most literal case of horse face that has ever existed.
Wow.
Our fearless pilot stares. Our fearless pilot stares directly into the storm of energy and lightning that awaits him. Will he be fried? Will he be torn asunder? It matters not. It must be done. And Maximilian Pegasus stands in the cockpit in the presence of the most undecided beacon of sexuality that has ever existed. And full forward, the engines turn on, the spaceship lifts off of what used to be the head of the Statue of Liberty and takes off into space! Engines full blast! Sobbing! And sexying! And confusion! And steering! And hacking! And unicorning! All at once, as you streak like a torpedo through space towards the crackling, flashing quantum tunnel, destabilizing and warping its shape and its presence, flickering in and out of existence like some kind of space storm, lightning and fire and smoke. And the beam of rainbow technology rockets forth from the windows and the cannons, full power towards the quantum tunnel, attempting to fight the destabilization. And without flinching, the pilot drives the Raptor directly into the quantum tunnel to give best access and best chance of restabilization. And you fight with all of your unicorn power to stabilize the tunnel, and the ship is torn asunder and thrown this way and that, and the consoles are exploding! It explodes!
Yay!
And then all of a sudden, with a violent shake, the entire ship is shaken so badly you are all thrown against the walls! Seatbelts should have been used, you never read that sign anyways, who listens to safety warnings? And it lights out for a lot of you. And when you come to, consciousness returns to you, and you wake up on the floor of the wreckage of the Raptor. Circuitry damaged almost beyond repair. The stench of spilled space fuel reaches your nostrils, chemical and harsh, burning your noses. Crash in Victor's body, clops to her feet, her hooves, her hands. So confusing. Victor Kuhl, in the body of a hot space babe, wakes up, immediately expecting his cleavage. Maximilian Pegasus, you wake up, blood in your eyes, uncertain of your victory, and with two heads. It is you, Randy Spacebuck, who can observe the fate of both yourselves and the universe. Up in the sky, a little too close to the Earth, you see the swirling, now stabilized mass of the quantum tunnel, hovering in the sky. And with your other head gazing through the shattered windows, you see the swaying grass and the palm trees and the untouched nature of planet Earth. And a pterodactyl sails through the air, and a triceratops clumps along the ground, eating the vegetation. You look over your shoulder, your temporal drive, your temporal yump drive, smashed in the crash. if your engineer can figure out how to rebuild any of this with hooves.
With hooves.
Only time will tell. You may have saved the universe, but it looks like you've crash-landed in history. Can you survive in the land before time? This has been twitch.tv/evilsqueegee. With laziness and feelings, ladies and gentlemen, a round of applause for our glorious players!
Zangmack! I want to destroy it now! I want to destroy it now and be like, I'm here to impregnate your women!
And that's all, folks!
Oh, man! Oh, man! With 15 minutes to spare, baby! This has been twitch.tv/evilsqueegee. I am Evil Squeegee. This has been Zangmack playing Randy Spacebuck, the apparently two-headed sexy scientist. Imagining Mystic playing Crash Quizbang, the dangerous engineer. Pyromancy
now
with his,
also a unicorn.
Pyromancy with his very first appearance on stream playing Victor Cool, the unicorn from space. And Johnable playing the intrepid pilot Maximilian Pegasus. A beat for all. Who won, by the way?
I'm pretty sure Zangmack.
Zangmack won. Yeah, a beat for all around. If you like this, you can catch us now. Every Sunday we're doing one-shots, baby. Every Sunday and Wednesday you can catch these sort of shenanigans. Dungeons & Dragons, Lasers & Feelings, Dungeon World, Shadowrun, you name it. It's going down, baby. Absolutely glad to have every last one of you here. It's been fucking incredible, all right?